Jesus called his 12 disciples to him and gave them authority to drive out evil spirits and to heal every disease and sickness.
The Bible contains remarkable stories of miracles and divine interventions. Moses parted the sea. Peter healed a man lame from his mother's womb. Jesus drove demons out of people and raised others from the dead. But are these types of events still happening today?
We too have a beam of divine light and guidance that God has put within the heart of every man. And it's one of the greatest proofs that there is a God.
More amazing supernatural things are happening than we realize.
This is Divine Intervention, the interview show that features intriguing people who've experienced the hand of God in amazing ways. Divine Intervention was created and produced with the purpose of encouraging believers, spiritual seekers, and skeptics alike that Jesus is alive and is still performing miracles and working in the world today.
I believe in miracles.
Here's your host, Daniel Fazina.
Hello, friend, and welcome to Divine Intervention Radio. I am your host, Daniel Fazina, and I am just so privileged and honored to be with you today. I got a wonderful guest in store with some amazing testimonies of how the Lord worked in her life. But before we get to our special guest, just want to remind you that you can tune in to divineinterventionradio.com to hear any of the archives you may have missed over the air. They're all archived there, and also facebook.com/divineinterventionradio, and you can also follow me on Twitter, DanielFazina1 on twitter.com. That's Daniel Fazina, the numeral 1, on twitter.com. You know, on this show, we feature a lot of really amazing miracles about answered prayers and near-death experiences, people who've been raised from the dead, healings, all sorts of things, the way that God intervenes in people's lives. But, you know, among one of the most powerful evidences of God, in my opinion, is a changed life and how prayer can change a person literally overnight sometimes. It can change a person's heart from being angry and bitter to being compassionate and loving, or from being hateful to being loving. It's just an amazing thing to witness and also to experience. And today's guest is someone who had a similar experience like that. We're talking about a changed life, and we'll also be talking about how the Lord carried her and her son and family through a diagnosis of leukemia. Our special guest today is Angela Heath, and she's an award-winning entrepreneur, a keynote speaker, and an author. And her upcoming book is titled Do the Hustle Without the Hassle, A Quick, Simple, Affordable Way for People 45 Plus to Make Money Online. She teaches people how to make money on their own using what they already know. So it's my pleasure to welcome Angela Heath right now on Divine Intervention Radio. Angela, you are on Divine Intervention Radio. Thanks so much for joining us.
Daniel, thank you so much for having me. I appreciate it.
Well, I appreciate you, and I appreciate the great work you're doing with kingscommission.org and you know, your heart to fund and finance the kingdom of God, and we definitely want to get to that. But before we do, why don't you take us to the beginning? Tell us a little bit about your background growing up and maybe how you came to know Jesus in the first place.
Well, I grew up in a Catholic home. I went to Catholic school all the way through college. And so I always knew the Lord. When I was younger, I would talk to the Lord. I never knew that God would talk back to us, but I always knew the Lord. But I really didn't know what it meant to have Jesus be Lord of my life.
Okay.
But I always knew God was real, and I always trusted him.
Okay. So was there a point that came in your life where you started to understand that, you know, he was real and that you could have a relationship, a two-way relationship with him, if you will?
Well, that came a little later in my life, because when I grew up in the church that I attended, we never talked about a personal relationship with God. We talked about him being the Father and the creator of all things, but that we were so far removed from him. And the grace of Jesus Christ was never emphasized that we could actually have any kind of personal relationship with the Lord. So that came along a little later in my life. After college, I moved to the Washington, D.C. area from Cincinnati. And I came across a group of people who were actually studying the Bible.
Oh, what a concept.
That was a novel idea for me. And I was attracted to that. I actually dated a guy who was an atheist and who told me he had studied the Bible for years and determined that it was just a book of stories, and I couldn't defend my faith.
Interesting.
And that's when I said to myself, how can I represent the Lord when I don't even know what his word says? And I started to get into the Bible, and then I started to realize that I can have a personal relationship with the Lord. But it was really that challenge and that group of individuals who were studying the Bible who really piqued my curiosity to know God.
Interesting. Funny you should mention that you were dating an atheist, because when I grew up, most of my friends were not Christian, and many of them were atheist and agnostic and Wiccan and pagan. And some of them had studied the Bible too, and they would challenge me constantly in my faith, you know, as a teenager and in my young 20s. So I had to really, know my stuff and be able to argue with apologetics and, and logic and reason and science and all that. Eventually I think I found it was more effective to just share my testimony and what God did for me. But those early years really, honed me and sharpened my skills, if you will. And I'm pleased to say many of them, some of them have come around and actually given their lives to Jesus since then. But we're talking over a 20-year time frame. But it's interesting how those arguments and stuff can really help you to get deeper in the Word and come to know the Lord in a more personal way.
So the gentleman that I was dating at the time when he challenged me, I was angry. I was angry because how dare you challenge what I believe and ask me to defend myself. But, as I grew in my faith, I understood that many of the people of the world, that's where they are. And so in order to reach them, our testimonies are powerful, but we have to really know who God is for ourselves before we can explain and share who God is with others.
Amen. I definitely appreciate that. So, okay, so going forward, you had a very interesting time involving your son and a pretty amazing series of divine interventions that happened with him. Can you tell us that story? What happened going forward?
So I met a man, and I knew God. I always tell people that I liked God, but I didn't really love God.
Okay.
I believed that he was real, but he was not Lord of my life. So I was living my own life. I met a man. I fell in love. I moved in with him. And after a few years, we decided we wanted to have a child. And I never wanted to get married because I looked at the world. I looked at movie stars and entertainers, and they were all having children, and they weren't getting married, and their life seemed well. So I thought, I can do the same thing. So we did. We had a son, and at the time, our relationship was starting to crumble, but I wanted to have a child so desperately. My thinking was, well, I'll just have a child, and then I'll leave him, and I'll go off on my own into the sunset, and everything will be great.
Interesting.
That was my thought.
So how did that work out?
It didn't. It didn't work out at all.
Okay.
After my child was about 1 year old, I did actually leave his father, and that started a really tough period in my life. Where my faith was really challenged, and it was just such an emotional turmoil. We were in court probably about 13 to 15 times.
Wow.
With a custody battle. His dad had decided, in my estimation, he wasn't a good father. He would, get our son and visit with him, and our son would return, and he'd say his dad never gave him anything to eat. Just a little guy. And, when it was time to buy shoes, he would, put him on little shoes that would hurt his feet, send him to daycare and those, and he just, he would have him in a room by himself, and say it was a childproof room, so he could do whatever he wanted to do. And so it was very hurtful for me. And during that time, I was studying the Bible, and I was, you know, loving the Lord. I had, you know, figured out that like and love are different things. And so I was looking through Scripture, and I was finding all of this evidence, and I was pounding on the doors of the courtroom of heaven saying, Father, I'm your daughter. He's not. He's in darkness. He doesn't believe. He's not a good dad. Take him out of our life. Take him out of our life forever. And it was just a constant. I mean, this went on for 5, 6, 7 years. In and out of court.
So you're praying this the whole time, and obviously the prayer is not being answered in the way you wanted it to. So what happened from there? I mean, you kept going, you kept persisting, but what ultimately you know, took place?
One of the things I wanted to share with your listeners, Daniel, is that my prayers were actually not steeped in any kind of true concern for my son.
Okay.
I mean, I was concerned for him, but the truth is that I was angry at his dad. And my heart had grown so cold toward his dad that I actually hated him. And I actually had daydreams that he would die and I would be at his funeral and I would be happy.
Wow.
So I didn't care if he went to hell or not. I had no concern for his salvation. So early, you know, later I realized that that kind of darkness in my heart, that I wasn't serving my son well, I wasn't serving the Lord well, even though I thought I was using scriptures almost like some kind of magical, you know, some kind of magic to make God do what I wanted him to do.
Oh, yes. Yep.
But long story short, the Lord knows better than us.
Thankfully, so, he does.
years go past, and about when my son was about 7 or 8 years old, one night I was lying on the floor, and I had been asking the Lord to change my heart. And I was just lying on the floor, and in the middle of the night, I woke up, and the Lord said, call him and tell him you are happy that he is your son's dad. And the Lord had pricked my heart to do things like this before, and I did it, but I had my teeth were clenched. I didn't believe it, and I didn't want to do it.
Right.
This was different. This time, my heart was filled with joy. I couldn't wait to tell him that, and I don't know what the Lord did to me during the middle of the night, but I was actually happy that he was my son's father. So when I delivered that message to him, he almost, I'm sure, fell out of bed. I called him first thing in the morning.
That's amazing.
And from that point on, God began to heal our relationship. It was absolutely amazing.
Isn't that amazing that, you know, on this show, we talk a lot about miracles. I mean, we've talked about people who've been raised from the dead and who've had conversion experiences and near-death experiences, healings, things like that. But I think it's just an amazing piece of evidence that God can change a person's heart, like, instantly, overnight. You know, I've had that happen to me and also to many people that I've interviewed. And that's one of the strongest pieces of evidence that there is a God, that he can change someone's heart just like that. And so, you know, getting back to your story, when you told him, you know, that you were happy that he was your son's father, what did he say? How did he react?
He was silent. I called him on the phone. He was silent. I mean, I'm sure he was stunned. and then he, you know, just kind of mumbled, thank you. But the amazing transformation, you know, my friends, they just saw my dark heart. They knew that, I was filled with venom myself because I was constantly complaining about him and talking bad about him. And so they began to witness how I would say nice things about him. I mean, it just started off with very small things. But on his side of the fence, he went from you know, not feeding my son to making these wonderful gourmet meals for my son.
Oh, wow.
He went from not wanting to, you know, purchase clothing items to actually giving him a little too much. He had made a statement that when my son was young that he would not pay for Christian education. And then he ended up paying for Christian education all throughout high school.
Mm. Wow.
So we both changed, and we were able to really co-parent together. And the change was so profound in us that people kept saying, you guys are going to get married. You guys are going to get married. We never did. We never will. But we've forgiven each other, and we've actually become more than just co-parents. We've actually have a friendship.
Wow.
I never thought we could have.
That is amazing. Just, you know, the Bible says that death and life are in the power of the tongue, you know, and there's so many scriptures that talk about how your words can affect people and how you can use them to sow life or death, you know, to slay with your tongue or to, you know, bring about life. And it's just, it amazes me how just with a little encouragement and positivity and just speaking those words of life, how a person's heart can melt and change, and you know, you can encourage them to be better, to reach their potential. And I think it's pretty obvious that, you know, the Lord was working both in your hearts and through your tongues through this, for this miracle of change to happen. That's pretty, that's really cool. I'm so happy for you guys.
So, you know, the other thing that I think is just very striking, Daniel, I think the fact that you could look on the outside and you could look at maybe all of the things that he did were not, you know, good things in terms of being a parent at that time. And you could look at me and I would go to court and I would try my best to be honest and forthright. So on the surface, you could look at that and think, oh, she's doing so well and he's doing so badly. But the truth of the matter is that I was worse than him.
Hmm.
Because I was the one who was filled with such hatred that I didn't care if he died and went to hell.
Wow.
That is so opposite of who we are as Christ carriers.
Right.
So I didn't know it at the time, of course, but my heart was probably the main focus of all of this, and I thought it was his because of what I could see in the natural. But in the spirit, there was a darkness inside of me that needed to be healed.
A lot of times when we're praying for situations, we want to pray for the other person to change or the other person to be removed or the situation to improve. And many times, as in your case, God says, no, I'm teaching you something through this. I'm using it to purify your own heart and to change your own heart. And, you know, that God has been doing that with me as well in several different areas where, you know, you pray about something and it's like, okay, well, maybe my attitude has to change. My heart has to change. And just hearing your story, I think I definitely relate to it and resonate with it. And I'm hoping that it's going to encourage our listeners as well. Friend, you're listening to Divine Intervention Radio. I am your host, Daniel Fazina, and we're visiting with our special guest, Angela Heath. She is an entrepreneur, a keynote speaker, and an author, and her website is kingscommission.org. And she was just sharing with us the miracle of the changed heart that she experienced both in her own life and the life of her son's father. Angela, I want to ask you, how did this change on both your parts? How did that affect your son?
I mean, it was just a tremendous change. During all of the turmoil, he had all kinds of stomach issues that were emotional.
Mm.
And so, you know, he would go to sporting events, and after the event was over, he didn't know, should he run to dad, should he run to mom, because we were sitting on the opposite sides of the field.
Wow.
So once we began to develop a friendship toward one another, it just relaxed him completely.
Mm. That's amazing. Yeah, there's so many physical problems can be attributed to emotional turmoil and you know, mental anguish and things like that. It's everything is connected, so I'm very happy that your son is better. But he did have his own health challenges besides that going forward. Can you tell us about, you know, what happened? God kind of prepared you in advance for what was coming, but please share with us what happened to your son after that.
Okay. So when my son was 12, I was actually at a Christian conference, and the minister was saying that, you know, a lot of people want to be, quote, unquote, famous in the Christian community, and that, you know, when we go for God with all of our hearts, we are to expect that there will be opposition against it. And so I had my hands up, and I was surrendering my life to the Lord, and I was saying, Lord, you know, whatever you want to do with my life. I went and picked my son up the same day. He was 12 years old, and he said, Mom, I'm having hot flashes. And I said, boys don't have hot flashes.
Especially not at 12.
But he was listening to me. That was one of the things I would say to girlfriends when they were grumpy.
Mm-hmm.
And he came back a couple hours later, and he said, I'm having a hot flash. And I put my hand on his forehead. He was burning up. He had 104 temperature.
My goodness.
So we took him to the hospital, and they thought it was a virus. And they told us to follow up with his pediatrician. So during that week, that Tuesday, so this was on a Saturday, on Tuesday we couldn't keep the fever down. We took him to the pediatrician. They ran blood work. That same day, I got a call from St. Jude's Children's Hospital for a donation.
Mm-hmm.
But this time, something hit me in the pit of my stomach. I didn't know what that was, but I felt something, you know, in the pit of my stomach. So Thursday morning, I wake up at 5:30, and I write in my journal, half asleep, is this leukemia?
Hmm.
And I go back to sleep. By Thursday afternoon, I get this call from the doctor that said, you have to come right away.
Oh, that's never a good sign.
Mind you, one of the more important pieces that I just overlooked is what happened while I was surrendering to the Lord. I actually saw a vision of my son with a bald head. I saw him graduating from, I thought it was high school. I saw him receiving an award, and I saw me as an old woman in the bed with him and some children. I assumed that they were his, and I was blessing them.
Hmm.
That's critical.
Okay.
So by the time we get to the doctor, she think it's mono, and I say to her, could this be leukemia? And she said, Mom, oh my gosh, no, we're not going to go that far. It's probably some type of virus. Well, we go to Children's for further investigation. Saturday morning, they're doing a bone marrow biopsy, and I tell his dad, they're looking for leukemia.
Oh, boy.
And he got angry at me because nobody had talked about cancer at that point.
Mm-hmm.
But the Lord had already prepared me. So when they came back and delivered the message that it, in fact, was leukemia, I didn't react the way I guess most people would assume. I didn't cry. I just said, what do we need to do?
Wow. That's amazing. I have a similar story with my own life, but that is, wow. I'm glad that the Lord prepared you for that. And we're up against a break, but when we come back, I want to hear how the Lord worked out all the details and what happened going forward. Friend, again, you're listening to Divine Intervention Radio. I'm your host, Daniel Fazina, and our special guest today is Angela Heath. We'll be right back with more right after the break. Stay with us.
We'll be right back with more from Daniel Fazina and Divine Intervention right after this. I believe in miracles.
Hi, I'm Kevin McCullough. You may know me from Fox News Television or talk radio. I talk a lot about things that affect people's lives on a regular basis. And one of the things I've always wondered if people woke up wondering each morning is, could I work for myself? Could I find a business that would allow me to use the skills I have to pursue revenue that I need so that I can build a vision that I have? How would you like to be your own boss with no commute, no alarm clock, no employees or politics or compromises or discrimination? None of that educational requirement, but something positive that actually impacts people's lives. That's the opportunity of Ambit, an energy business that you can not only own now for less than $500, but make lots of money with. Call for your start today at 205-55-AMBIT. That's 205-55-AMBIT, or online at freepowernow.com.
Hey, this is Daniel Fazina of Divine Intervention Radio. The Bible contains some incredible stories of miracles and divine interventions. Jesus calmed a raging storm, healed paralytics, and even raised the dead. But are these types of events still happening today? The answer to this question, as you will see from reading my book, Divine Intervention, 50 True Stories of God's Miracles Today, is an emphatic yes. Contained within the book is a collection of amazing true stories that attest to this fact. You will read the astonishing firsthand accounts of people who have been healed of paralysis, terminal cancer, and tumors through prayer. You will see the love of God powerfully transform the life of an Islamic terrorist. You will witness the liberation of the demon-possessed, the resurrection of the dead, and much more. Prepare to be awed and inspired as you experience divine intervention. More information about Divine Intervention, 50 True Stories of God's Miracles Today, can be found at www.divineinterventionradio.com or by calling 800-247-4788. That's 1-800-247-4784. Divine Intervention welcomes the support of Letierzo Associates, Certified Public Accountants. Letierzo Associates, Certified Public Accountants, is a family-owned and operated Christian business serving their clients with quality accounting services for over 40 years, offering full-service accounting for any type of business, large or small, in any state of the union. Letierzo Associates, Certified Public Accountants, 12 Oak Street, No. 5, West Hampton Beach, New York, 11978. Phone 631-288-3334. That's 631-288-3334. First Steps to Success with ABC's secret millionaire, Danny Johnson, gives you the tools to remap your internal beliefs about yourself, about your money, and about others. You'll learn a simple but powerful system to create success in any environment, as well as business building, leadership, sales, and marketing skills to create the lifestyle most only dream about.
Prior to getting started with Danny, I was a civil engineer working paycheck to paycheck, no retirement, no savings. Had a lot of dreams and goals and couldn't figure out how I was going to get to those. Started plugging into Danny, started my own engineering business, and this year we'll do about $600,000 in revenue. I paid off $50,000 in debt in 2.5 years. More than the money, a great relationship with my wife and my kids. Just amazing 2.5 years.
First Steps to Success with Danny Johnson is about becoming the leader you were called to be. More information about Danny Johnson and First Steps to Success can be found at DannyJohnson.com or by calling 866-760-8255. Times are tough, not getting easier, but there's an opportunity that could make a significant change in your financial situation. People are paying too much for home utilities, and everybody has them. Help friends and family save money and get paid for it. No obligation. You don't even have to talk to anyone unless you want to. Just listen to a 3-minute recorded message. Call now, 715-GET-CASH. That's 715-GET-CASH. Listen, decide, and you could be on your way to a better tomorrow. 715-438-2274. That's 715-GET-CASH.
Hi, this is Cha-Cha from The Sopranos and the unofficial mayor of Little Italy, and you're listening to Divine Intervention with Daniel Fazina.
Well, the sun comes.
Welcome back to Divine Intervention Radio. I'm your host, Daniel Fazina, www.divineinterventionradio.com. And if you're just joining us, we have been speaking with Angela Heath, and she is an award-winning entrepreneur, a keynote speaker, and an author. And her website is kingscommission.org. Angela, welcome back.
Thank you.
You're welcome. So before the break, Angela, we were talking about how your son was coming to you with hot flashes, and then you took him into the hospital, and the Lord had kind of prepared you for the possibility of leukemia. And, you know, no one else really was going that route, but eventually it turned out after a bone marrow biopsy that it was indeed leukemia. What happened from there?
Well, when we broke the news to my son, the Lord had already prepared him, because when I came home after the vision, I didn't tell him about the bald head. I said, I saw a vision of your future. I saw you graduating from high school, and you're going to get an award, a huge award. And I saw me blessing your children. Hmm. I was old. So that's all I told him. So when we came to him and we had to break the news, he didn't know what leukemia was.
Okay.
He was 12.
Right, okay.
And he said, Mom, is this, like, serious? And I said, for some people it can be. Mm-hmm. I said, but remember, God already gave us a vision of your future, so Satan can't take your life. And my son's response was, he can't take it. He's just trying to threaten me.
Amen. Right. Wow.
And he went through that 3.5 years of treatment, never believing that this was a life-threatening illness.
That's amazing. He had childlike faith, huh?
He did. And I just love the Lord for giving us that heads up, because even his dad came around because he was really upset. But I had my journal, and so he could see in my journal chronologically what happened. And so we were all at such an incredible place of peace that people couldn't even understand. The doctors, the nurses, they were like, your family is just like unbelievable. Hmm. You know, you don't complain about anything. You're always positive. You know, you're not filled with fear. You know, and there were some scary times, I guess, in the natural, but it was just an incredible peace.
That's amazing. And that, again, is another testament to the Lord's presence. You know, Jesus said, my peace I give you, I leave you, not as the world gives. He said it's the peace that the world can't give and the world can't take away. You know, he didn't promise us that life would be always very smooth and, you know, roses all the time, but he did promise to give us peace in the midst of the storm, the storms of life. You know, he said, you know, in this world you'll have trouble, but take heart, I've overcome the world. And you've experienced that, obviously. I experienced that as well, also going through cancer. When I was having chest pains and going to the hospital, the Lord had prepared me, too, for the possibility of cancer. And I didn't know where it came from. It just kind of popped into my mind that this could be, you know, cancer. And at that time, there was no previous indications, no symptoms. This was my first time, you know, getting checked out for anything. And, you know, weeks and weeks later, it was finally diagnosed. But God had prepared me in some sense and given me peace, you know, in the midst of that. And all throughout my treatment as well, I experienced similar things that where people were like, how are you so calm and peaceful throughout it all? And it was definitely the peace of the Lord. So I'm very thankful for that. And I'm thankful that he gave it to you as well. Now, you said there were some scary times going through, and you had some close calls and some miracles along the way. Tell us about a few of those incidences.
Well, when you have leukemia, any time you have a fever, you have to rush to the hospital immediately. Mm. Because the chemotherapy decreases your immune system.
Right.
And any kind of virus or bacteria could actually end up being deadly in less than a day. So whenever my son would have fevers at the beginning of this journey, I lived about 40 minutes from the hospital.
Okay.
you know, I would be driving down to the hospital, but there would be a little bit of franticness in my voice. I would be praying the healing scriptures, but it would be a little bit of franticness in my voice. And many times we get down there and the fever was gone.
Amen.
So what God was telling me is that you can relax through this journey. So when he would get fevers again, you know, as after a few months, I would drive down and I made up my own praise song of, you know, his presence was just filling the car, that his presence was just righting every wrong, that he was a good and faithful God, and that everything was working well. And we would get to the hospital so many times to the point where they would say to me, why do you guys keep coming down here? I think you want to live down here. The fever would be gone.
Wow, that's amazing.
The fever would be gone. But one of the really amazing things that happened is my son got a chemotherapy burn.
Okay. And for those who aren't familiar with that, what does that entail? What is that like?
So sometimes when you are being injected with the chemotherapy at the injection site, it can actually burn because it's a chemical. So you can have a chemical burn that's very similar to a second or third degree fire burn.
Okay, and this comes from under the skin?
It goes into the vein. So it actually burns up the vein and the outer layers of the skin.
Oh, wow. That doesn't sound good.
It doesn't sound good. But even with the chemotherapy burn, it was just not the natural course. Typically what happens is once the chemotherapy is injected, the burn happens immediately, and they take it out, and then they'll put something else in to calm the tissues.
Okay.
Well, with my son, they put it in, and there was this shadow of a line going up his veins, but, you know, we didn't really notice it until I got home. So it wasn't the extreme reaction like you typically have. So by the time we went home, we could see that there was this darkness that was going up his vein. So when I bring him back to the hospital, they said, oh my gosh, it's a chemotherapy burn. You know, here's a prescription for this. If you have pain, do that. We left the hospital, and one nurse said to my son, I'm sorry, but this is going to take a really long time to go away. I mean, it's going to take a really long time to go away, but it will go away. You know, it may take a really long time, but it will go away. It will go away eventually.
Okay. All right.
Another nurse says, oh, I've never seen a chemotherapy burn. You know, oh, let me see it. So they were all gathered around. We never filled the prescription. We come back in 3 weeks, and you can't even tell which arm was burned. And I was so excited. When we came in, one of the nurses ran out because she was off duty, and she was his primary nurse. And she said, oh, my God, I heard about the burn. And she looked at the arm, and then she looked at the other arm. She's like, which arm? Where's the burn? And I said, we went to a specialist. And she said, a dermatologist? I said, no, his name was Jesus Christ.
Amen.
There was no evidence, no evidence that he had ever been burned.
So when they say a long time to heal, I mean, how long does it usually take for a chemotherapy burn to heal? Is there any?
Years.
Years. Okay, wow.
And this was like a couple weeks.
That's amazing. So, yeah, I mean, Jesus is the great physician, right? He's our healer, and the Bible says that by his stripes we are healed. I had to stand on those promises many times going through cancer and chemotherapy myself. I never got a chemo burn, thankfully, but I did have other things. I mean, did your son have a portacatheter or a PICC line inserted into his skin at any point?
Yes, he did have a port.
He had a port. So then you'll understand this. For anyone listening who's not familiar with what a portacatheter is, it's basically like a titanium ring that they surgically implant just below the skin. And it has a tube that goes into a major vein or artery. So what happens is they can puncture the skin right above the ring, and they can inject chemotherapy easily, and they can also draw blood from it. So what happened with mine was, believe it or not, after I had it in for a couple of months, the plastic tubing that was attached to the titanium ring actually broke off and got flushed down this major vein, and it went into my heart. And it actually worked its way through the different chambers of my heart and got spit out the other side and got stuck in my pulmonary artery. And while this was happening, I felt my heart begin to flutter uncontrollably. I had no idea what was going on. I thought I was having a heart attack. They didn't actually find out what happened until about 2 weeks later when I went in for my regularly scheduled chemotherapy treatment. They couldn't access the port. They thought it had gotten clogged up, so they gave me an anticoagulant drug. They said, come back the following day. So I come back. They still can't access it. Finally, they sent me for an x-ray, and they found out that the tube was way below where it should have been, and it had been stuck in this pulmonary artery for over 2 weeks. And so they had to admit me for surgery immediately, and they had to go in with a catheter through a major vein or artery in my groin and snake it all the way up through my heart and lasso this tube and pull it out through my heart and down and out. And it took several, it was like 4 or 5 hours. I was awake during the whole thing, and the doctors were so surprised because they said it could have been a source of infection. It could have punctured my heart, my lungs, could have caused a heart attack, could have caused a blood clot, could have killed me, basically should have killed me.
Absolutely.
If not for the grace of God, it was God's hand of protection over me. And, you know, I think Satan was trying to take me out, and God was like, nope, I'm not done with him yet. But it was just an amazing thing. And they all said it was so rare that that happens. And, you know, it was just one of the many miracles I experienced. So just wanted to share that testimony with you real quick.
That's amazing.
God is in control. You know, we do what we can. We do the best we can with what we have to try and take care of ourselves and be good stewards of our body and our health, but ultimately it's God who decides when we die, you know, and if it's not your time, it's not your time. If God has more for you to do, it doesn't matter. He will keep you here until it's your appointed time.
Absolutely.
So just let that be an encouragement to you.
You know, one of the things that happened when my son was young that I thought was so funny, you know, a lot of the kids on the ward, they were, you know, going to the ICU unit for various things.
Mm-hmm.
And he went down one time to ICU for observation. And he was in the ICU ward complaining about the food. So the nurse comes in and she says, son, what are you complaining about? Do you know most kids on this unit don't eat because they can't eat?
Oh, wow.
So he's in ICU complaining about food. We're bringing him food, and he's around kids who are, you know, almost comatose.
Wow.
He's alert. He's looking at TV, watching cartoons. He's eating his favorite foods. He's like having a vacation in ICU.
How did the nurse's comment, did that change his attitude a little bit, or what?
You know, he was 12 or 13 at the time, and so he was still thinking like a kid.
Sure.
So I don't think my son really understands how much grace was on his life.
Mm-hmm.
Because God, I mean, he went through some things, but God spared him from so much that I don't think he really got the appreciation for what God brought him through.
How old is he now?
He's 21 now.
21, okay, awesome. And he's doing well?
He is doing well. He did have a relapse, actually, last year.
Okay.
And he had a bone marrow transplant. So he stayed out of college for a year, but he's back in college, and he's doing very well.
That's so good. I'm very glad to hear that. It's just amazing how, you know, God carries us through, and it's obvious that he has a plan for your son's life. And I'm sure going forward, he will come to appreciate, as he gets older and more mature, you know, what God carried him through. Because, I mean, leukemia is no joke. It's, you know, it can be very serious, very deadly. I've lost friends to leukemia, more than one. So I know it's nothing to be taken lightly. So I'm very, very happy that your son came through it and that he's doing well.
You know, the other piece of this that I believe the Lord is doing is really positioning him for his calling. My son is majoring in biomedical engineering.
Mm.
And when he was inpatient last summer, he had applied for an internship in the biomedical engineering department at Children's Hospital. Well, he was inpatient on the last day of the interview.
Wow.
And he was determined he was going to sign himself out of the hospital, go to the interview, and come back.
That's
well,
dedication.
The doctors agreed that he could go. But he couldn't, he didn't have a lot of energy at that time, so just going, you know, to that interview and back was exhausting.
Mm-hmm.
But he was determined to do it. And now he's beginning to really, you know, start to figure out that maybe there is something for him to do to help make this journey easier. I believe, you know, what Satan meant for evil, God will definitely use for good in his life.
That's right. Amen for that. I find that so many people, they find their passion and their calling through their own suffering and their own experiences many, many times. Not always, but many times a trauma or some type of adverse circumstances comes into someone's life and they are able to turn that around and use it to help others going through a similar situation. Isn't that funny how life works like that? But I don't know. I don't fully understand it, but sometimes that's the way it works. And I'm just I'm thankful that many people do find that, you know, in their lives. Friend, you're listening to Divine Intervention Radio. Our special guest is Angela Heath. She's an award-winning entrepreneur, keynote speaker, and author, and her website is kingscommission.org. Now, Angela, you've told us some of the miracles and divine interventions that have happened in your life as far as changing your heart and healing your son, but tell us about your passion and your ministry to support and fund the kingdom of God. What's that all about? Tell us about King's Commission.
Well, the King's Commission is a small ministry, but we do a big work for the Lord. Our goal is to support the Great Commission. So we partner with existing Bible translation organizations, and we send Bibles to parts of the world where they may be considered illegal or where Christians are being persecuted.
Hmm.
We also support missionaries, because one of the things the Lord said to me is that I was not called to go, and I thank him for that. I don't think I'm built for that. But he said, I'm called to help them stay.
Okay.
So we send out these oasis boxes, and they're filled with things that U.S. missionaries can't get abroad. So little trinkets to say, you know, good job, God loves you, keep it going, things that they cannot get abroad. So, you know, over-the-counter medications, deodorant, little lotions, gum for children, you know, candies from here. So it's these oasis boxes are just to bring a little bit of the U.S. to them, because sometimes it can be very challenging when they don't have anything that they're used to when they're abroad.
Mm.
And we also do a lot of discipleship and training specifically for women around their divine purpose and helping them to walk in that purpose.
That's awesome. So if anyone wants to find out more and maybe donate or support your organization, how can they do that?
They can go to our website and get more information at kingscommission.org, or they can actually send me an email at angela@kingscommission.org. We are always looking for missionaries to support. We are always looking for women who know God is calling them to something higher, that we can make some deposits into their lives. We are actually having our annual New Year's Fellowship in the Washington, D.C. area on January 20th. It's a free day where women come together. We seek the Lord for what he has for the new year, and then we commit to that, whatever he's calling us to do. So that'll be January 20th in the Washington, D.C. area.
That's January 20th of 2018.
Yes.
That's awesome. Well, Angela, we're just about out of time here, but it's been a real pleasure speaking with you. I guess the last thing is, if there's someone listening to this broadcast right now who may be struggling with knowing God, or they just don't know if he's even out there for them, what would be your encouragement to them?
You know, my encouragement and my challenge to anyone who is struggling in this area, just say these words. Lord, if you are real, Jesus, if you are God, reveal yourself to me. And God is faithful. He will show you who he is. He will show up in your life in such a powerful way that you would never deny his existence again.
Amen. Well, thank you very much, Miss Angela Heath of kingscommission.org. It's been a pleasure. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Have a great day.
All right. Well, friend, that about does it for another episode of Divine Intervention Radio. I hope it has encouraged you to know that God is real. He is still doing miracles in the world, changing hearts and lives one person at a time. Tune in next time for another exciting episode of Divine Intervention Radio. Take care and God bless.
You've been listening to Divine Intervention with your host, Daniel Fazina. You can email Daniel at divineintervention@mail.com. That's divineintervention@mail.com. All programs of Divine Intervention are available online at divineinterventionradio.com. That's divineinterventionradio.com. Join us next time here on Divine Intervention.
Hi, I'm Kevin McCullough. You may know me from Fox News or talk radio. Have you ever wondered or pondered the idea of working for yourself or owning your own business? Using your skills to build a vision or a passion for your own life? Think about it. No boss, no politics, no compromise, no commute, no employees, no discrimination, and no educational requirements. Just building something positive that impacts people's lives. Well, you can get started owning your own energy company for less than $500. Would you like to know how? It's through a great company called Ambit. You can find out more when you go to freepowernow.com. That's freepowernow.com. Or if you're really interested in getting started, call my good friend Daniel Fazina, an independent energy consultant with Ambit. He's ready to help you get started on a brand new career. 205-55-AMBIT. That's 205-55-AMBIT or freepowernow.com.
Divine Intervention welcomes the support of Letierzo Associates, Certified Public Accountants. Letierzo Associates, Certified Public Accountants is a family-owned and operated Christian business serving their clients with quality accounting services for over 40 years. Offering full-service accounting for any type of business, large or small, in any state of the union. Letierzo Associates, Certified Public Accountants, 12 Oak Street, No. 5, West Hampton Beach, New York, 11978. Phone 631-288-3334. That's 631-288-3334. Hey, this is Daniel Fazina of Divine Intervention Radio. The Bible contains some incredible stories of miracles and divine interventions. Jesus calmed a raging storm, healed paralytics, and even raised the dead. But are these types of events still happening today? The answer to this question, as you will see from reading my book, Divine Intervention, 50 True Stories of God's Miracles Today, is an emphatic yes. Contained within the book is a collection of amazing true stories that attest to this fact. You will read the astonishing firsthand accounts of people who have been healed of paralysis, terminal cancer, and tumors through prayer. You will see the love of God powerfully transform the life of an Islamic terrorist. You will witness the liberation of the demon-possessed, the resurrection of the dead, and much more. Prepare to be awed and inspired as you experience divine intervention. More information about Divine Intervention, 50 True Stories of God's Miracles Today, can be found at www.divineinterventionradio.com or by calling 800-247-4784. That's 1-800-247-4784.